Hello, I'm Shane Benjamin with the Durango Herald, and welcome to Facebook Live, where we're bringing you the news conference around Mark Redwine's arrest. He was picked up Saturday at Bellingham, Washington, on suspicion of second-degree murder and child abuse causing death. He's being held today on $1 million cash-only bail in a Washington detention center. Pretty soon, the sheriff, LaPlata County Sheriff Sean Smith, and District Attorney Christian Champagne will arrive to give us a briefing about the arrest and the indictment against Mark Redwine, who's accused of killing his son, 13-year-old Dylan Redwine. Mark Redwine is scheduled for an extradition hearing August 17th, at which time he will waive or contest extradition from Washington State to Colorado. Dylan went missing on November 18th or November 19th, 2012. He was living with his mother at the time in Colorado Springs, but arrived in Durango, Colorado on November 18th, 2012 for a court-ordered visit with his father. A grand jury indictment was issued against Mark Redwine on last week. He was arrested Saturday in Bellingham, Washington, on suspicion of second-degree murder and child abuse causing death. The indictment, 4 pages, has many details that have never been shown or shared until now. According to that indictment, when Dylan arrived, he was seen in the LaPlata County Airport on video surveillance, and according to the indictment, he had little interaction with his father. Several people have said that he did not want to be here, did not want to come to visit. After the airport, they went to Walmart and to McDonald's, and then it's believed that they went to Mark Redwine's home north of Vallecito Reservoir, and he was never heard from again. Dylan's disappearance set off a multi-day search. Law enforcement searched the Vallecito Reservoir and scoured the rugged wilderness around Mark Redwine's house. They didn't find any signs of Dylan Redwine until June 2013, more than 6 months after he was reported missing, when they found some remains up on Middle Mountain, which is about 8 miles from Mark Redwine's house to the east. In November 2015, investigators, or hikers I should say, found a skull belonging to Dylan. Had some small markings possibly caused from a knife. So again, I'm Shane Benjamin. I'm with the Durango Herald, and we're about to begin a news conference with the LaPlata County Sheriff Sean Smith and District Attorney Christian Champagne. We don't know for sure that Mark will fight extradition. He has a hearing scheduled for extradition on August 17th.
Good afternoon and welcome. Thank you all for being here today to discuss the recent developments in our community's longstanding work to bring justice for Dylan Redwine. Today you will hear from LaPlata County Sheriff Sean Smith and 6th Judicial District Attorney Christian Champagne. Following their statements, the sheriff and Mr. Champagne will be answering questions, and I will moderate those questions. I would ask that during that question and answer period, you provide your name, your media outlet, and direct your question to either the sheriff or to Mr. Champagne. We're gonna wrap up here at 3:30, and following that, Mr. Champagne and the sheriff will be available for one-on-one interviews, but I'd like to ask that you arrange those with me following the press conference. Elaine Hall, Dylan's mother, is here in the room with us this afternoon, and she will be holding a press conference in this room beginning at 4:30 and ending promptly at 5. We invite you all to attend that session with us this afternoon. Thank you again for being here. Now I'll introduce LaPlata County Sheriff Sean Smith.
Good afternoon, and thank you for being here today. As you heard a moment ago, my name is Sean Smith, and I am the LaPlata County Sheriff. We are here today to discuss the indictment and arrest of Mark Redwine for the 2012 death of his son, Dylan, a 13-year-old young boy that died while visiting his father. The loss of this young man has been very traumatic for our community, and I believe that we all share in the grief that Dylan's mother, Elaine, and the rest of his loved ones are experiencing. This investigation has often been referred to as the journey to justice for Dylan, and I believe that's exactly what it is. Mark's arrest last Friday night in Washington, just before midnight, represents the end of one road and the beginning of another in that journey. My team is very proud of the work they have done to get us to this point. However, we recognize that there is a legal process ahead, and we will remain committed until the end. After 4.5 years, I know many of you are asking questions about the length of the investigation, but I believe it tells a powerful story by itself. The length of the investigation shows just how committed our team of investigators has been. Never giving up and keeping the goal of justice for Dylan each and every day. This team put in countless hours ensuring that no stone was left unturned, literally. Excuse me for a moment. Because they were committed to finding justice for this 13-year-old man, young man who lost his life over the Thanksgiving holiday in 2012. I want to take a minute to recognize our team of investigators because they have been the heart and soul of this investigation since the beginning. Without the commitment of this group of professionals, we would not be here today. This is Lieutenant Tanya Goldbright, Sergeant Tom Cowing, and Sergeant Jim Azell. They truly are the ones that need the recognition today for the efforts that have been put on this case. From the outset, this investigation has been a team effort. In addition to the men and women of the LaPlata County Sheriff's Office, we have received assistance from more than 30 agencies that you will see listed on the screens here today. In just a minute. We would also not be here today without the support we received from the amazing group of volunteers in our community. This tragedy has demonstrated the strength of our community and what we can do when we come together for a common purpose, justice for Dylan Redwine.
This case represents a terrible tragedy. A family's worst nightmare. When Dylan disappeared in 2012, we all lost something. The Redwine family lost an amazing, special young man, and many of us in our community lost our sense of safety, trust, and security in our own homes, for ourselves and for our children. Since that day, we have not stopped working for justice for Dylan, his family, and the entire community. We have endlessly analyzed the evidence, and I and my predecessor had to make the tough decision to exercise the patience necessary to make this case as strong as possible. Our patience has paid off, and we now believe we have the evidence we need to proceed forward and get justice for Dylan Redwine. The entire community has been committed to bringing justice for Dylan since he disappeared in 2012. This dedication reaches far outside our community, and we are honored to have the investigators and attorneys from the 1st, 2nd, and 20th Judicial Districts working with us on this important case. The grand jury indictment affirms for me that our hard work was worth every bit of the effort. The exhaustive searches, the meticulous evidence gathering, the painstaking analysis. Now we will bring the quest for justice for Dylan, his family, and the community to the judicial process. We are very confident that the case our expansive team has built will bring about the resolution for Dylan and his family that this case requires. Through the next phase, the 6th Judicial District Attorney's Office will work to bring justice for Dylan and his family and this entire community. Justice requires that as we move forward, the process is fair to all those involved, and that the integrity and impartiality of the judicial system is protected. Every day we have worked on this case, we remember that a young boy lost his life. Now is the time to bring justice for Dylan, his family, and this community, and heal and work together to end this terrible nightmare. Thank you.
Thank you, gentlemen. Now begin with questions. Who would like to start? Do you have a question? Shane? Can you state your name and how that please?
Sure. Shane Benjamin with the Durango Herald. And I'm wondering if you guys can answer today what you think Mark Redwine's motive might have been for killing his son.
The question is, what do we think Mark Redwine's motive might have been? Would you like to direct that question to the sheriff or the district attorney?
Let's do the district attorney.
You know, this case has been a long road. In order to protect the impartiality of the case, the integrity of the prosecution, we're not going to be able to get into the details of our strategy, of what the evidence represents and what we think his motive is. But I look forward to discussing it with you later as the case develops further.
Okay. Thank you.
Tony Kopolowski with Denver 7. Talking to people with me in the past few days, questions have come up about the length of time. Why now? Was there evidence that turned up in the past couple weeks or months? Much of the evidence that's discussed in the indictment is evidence that appears you were aware of for at least more than a year. So, community wanting to know why it took this long, can you provide specifics that led you to Saturday's arrest and what may have delayed that?
Okay, the question is about length of time for leading into Saturday's arrest and what evidence may have contributed to decision to make that arrest now. Mr.
Chairman. If we can have both respond, it would be great.
Okay.
Do I have to go first?
As we said a minute ago, we're not going to shy away from the fact that this was a lengthy process. We believe it makes us in a better position today than had we gone earlier. You only get one chance in the judicial process to get things right. When I first met with Elaine after my election, we talked about that very fact and that we wanted to have the very best case to bring to justice. Our team has never given up. They have worked, and we believe that the time put in has got us to the position that we need to be in to bring this case to justice today.
This is about getting it right and doing justice for Dylan, and sometimes that takes time to build the evidence. Every step in the process along the way has been critical. The the discovery of Dylan's skull in November of 2015 was definitely a turning point for us, and we felt that that was a critical piece of evidence that would allow us to present to a grand jury and to seek the justice for Dylan that he deserves.
Christian Ramirez with AOD and Albuquerque. I'm going to follow up on Tony just to push you on this same question. Is there new evidence? Was there something new that happened in the last couple of years?
The question is whether there is new evidence that has arisen in the last couple of years that prompted last week's indictment arrest.
Again, I would refer you to the fact that, you know, the finding of Dylan's skull on Middle Mountain was really a critical piece for us. That really helped us turn a corner in the investigation. It's a cumulative effort. Every piece of evidence that we've developed along the way has led us to this point, but that was definitely a very critical factor for us to be able to present the case.
Greg Minto, Channel 2 and Fox out of Denver. Can you talk about the teamwork, specifically Friday into Saturday, between LaPlata County and Bellingham, Washington? I mean, you go from this point from grand jury indictment to communicating with folks up there, and how that process worked. Specifically, there were things in the arrest warrant that talked about cell phone pinging and whatnot to narrow down where he was at.
Question is about the process leading to Mr. Redwine's arrest and how the coordination between the various agencies went. Sure, sir.
So, immediately following the indictment and the issuance of the warrant in this case, two of these investigators, along with a third, jumped in a vehicle and started heading for the Washington State area. We had information to believe that that's where Mr. Redwine was going to be. He works as an over-the-road truck driver. And our information indicated that he would be then making a route out to New York. Our team was working closely with the Washington State Patrol on trying to get into position. And I was working directly with Sergeant Fahler from the Washington State Patrol on helping to identify the truck and some processes that went into that. What we learned along the way is that at some point Mr. Redwine was turned around for being overweight in his vehicle, as many commercial truck drivers typically get in that situation, and was sent back to the original place, Bellingham, Washington, where his vehicle had been loaded to get reloaded. At that point, the information coming in from the United States Marshals was giving us the pinging location of his phone, which we secured with a warrant after search warrant after the indictment was issued. I went to our local dispatch center and coordinated with the Bellingham Police Department at that point to bring Mr. Redwine into custody.
Matt Crosher with CBS 4 in Denver. What happens now? How do we get Mark Redwine back to Colorado? How does that process work on Colorado's side? What's being done?
Question is regarding returning Mr. Redwine to Colorado and what the judicial process will be for returning him here. Mr. Champion.
The next step in the process is that Mark Redwine is facing extradition proceedings in the state of Washington. Our office is working on what's called a governor's warrant. We sent that off this afternoon for the governor to review. Once the governor reviews the governor's warrant and signs it, it will be forwarded on to the governor of the state of Washington. He will then review it and forward it on to the Superior Court in Whatcom County, Washington, where Mr. Redwine is being held. Mr. Redwine has due process rights in an extradition setting, whereby he will have the right to challenge extradition, in which case there would be a hearing where the Whatcom County prosecutor, Dave McEachran, would have to establish probable cause that a crime occurred in Colorado and that it was committed by Mark Redwine. Once he establishes that, the extradition would be ordered by the judge and Mr. Redwine would be returned to the state of Colorado. Mr. Redwine also has the option to waive his right to challenge the extradition, in which case he would be returned much more quickly and be back in Colorado within short order.
Is asking these gentlemen to
yes, but due to ethical concerns, we're not going to get into specifics of the case and all of the evidence that we have at this time. The information released in the indictment is about as far as we are able to go at this point from an investigative standpoint.
And I would echo Sheriff Smith's comments. It's extremely important that we protect the integrity of the judicial process. And part of that means that we're not going to be making comments on some of the potentially prejudicial evidence in the case about Mr. Redwine. And as a result, I really can't discuss the details of what's in those pictures further. We follow the evidence, and we let the evidence dictate to us what the charges should be. So we're not coming into this one with an agenda, seeking a particular charge. The evidence dictates to us that these are the appropriate charges, and that's what the grand jury was presented with and what they indicted on.
Devin Neely with KOBTV in Albuquerque, this is for district attorney. When it comes to time for trial, do you feel confident that you'll be able to impanel a jury here in LaPlata County, or will that have to be moved somewhere else?
Question is regarding the ability to impanel a jury for Mr. Redwine's future trial in LaPlata County for Mr. Shanty.
That is our goal. We believe that the people of this county deserve the opportunity to hear this case, and we're going to do everything within our power to keep this case here within LaPlata County so that our residents can be part of the resolution of this case and see that justice is done.
And you just want to say,
regarding whether Mr. Redwine's motive may have been linked to a confrontation regarding the compromising photographs, and that's Mr. Champagne.
The compromising photographs are certainly a point of contention between Dylan and his father, and beyond that, I'm really not going to be able to delve into the details of the events of that evening with you. But it is mentioned in the indictment because we think that it's an important part of the case and an important part of the probable cause analysis that supports the charges.
Additional questions?
For both District Attorney Champagne and Sheriff Smith, I heard your answers and they asked the same question in a different way. You said that there's no additional evidence that's come forward, or at least you're not sharing. Can you help the people of this community understand why charges were not filed a year ago or 2 years ago, why Dylan's dad was not arrested well before the 7th?
Question regarding timing on the arrest, whether there is any additional evidence that has been revealed in the last year or two for Mr. Smith.
I'll go first if that's okay. Essentially, process plays a big role in a criminal investigation. I know a lot of people nowadays watch CSI and they expect things to happen in a one-hour TV show. That's not the way that law enforcement truly works. The many partners that we've worked with are forensics labs and the FBI and experts in their field that we needed to do critical analysis on the evidence that has been collected in this case, and that takes time, significant time to begin.
You know, the thing I'll add to that is that, you know, while that process is occurring, our team is working behind the scenes to build this case. My intention all along has been to be ready for trial on the day that we present to the grand jury. And so, in order to get it right, in order to get justice for Dylan, we wanted to take our time, be methodical, and do things correctly. Time was on our side, and we took advantage of that opportunity, and now it's time for justice for Dylan.
Shane Benjamin, Durango Herald. I'm curious if you guys notified the father when you found the skull. Did he know about that?
Question is whether the investigators notified Mr. Redline when the skull was found.
Excuse me for a moment. I defer to my team. I don't believe that we made notification to Mr. Redwine of that at any point. So that information, if he received it, would not have come from our office.
No.
Do you have an overriding message that you wanted to convey to the community and or Mr. Redwine himself based on this 4.5 year process? Is there a message that you'd like to send with this opportunity?
Question is whether Sheriff Smith or District Attorney Champagne has an overriding message that they'd like to send to the community or to Mr. Redline. Again, with Sheriff Smith.
I guess to sum it up, we've got to remember why we're here today. We're not here because this investigation took a long time. We're not here today because there's questions around the evidence and the indictment. We're here today because we have all been engaged in a process to find justice for Dylan Redline, a young boy who lost his life. And whatever amount of time that took to get there, we were willing to do it. When I say they left no stone unturned, literally, you should go back and look at some of what took place during our investigation. We're here for that one purpose, because a young man lost his life, and we needed to bring justice for him and some healing to the family and our community.
I would echo what Sheriff Smith has to say. It's time. It's time for justice. The time is now. We've been working behind the scenes on this case tirelessly. We've never given up. And our community, Dylan's family, and Dylan's memory deserve justice now. We're ready to bring that justice.
Question for the district attorney. How important was the outside expertise and help offered by the other district attorney offices and the folks who kind of came in here and helped this process along? Would we be here today if it wasn't for that help?
Question is regarding the cooperation that folks received from outside agencies, other district attorney's offices, whether we would be here today without that assistance. Mr. Champagne.
Their assistance and support has been absolutely critical in the case. The 20th Judicial District, 1st Judicial District, 2nd Judicial District, lent us attorneys and investigators. They have worked countless hours on this case, preparing it for the grand jury, preparing it for trial, and they have been absolutely invaluable. And I think what it really speaks to is how this case has grown in importance in the public's mind. We've had support and outpouring of support statewide, nationwide. We've had experts in from all over the country. We've had people who have volunteered their time to assist us in preparing and analyzing the evidence. And every piece of that support has been absolutely critical for us to be here standing in front of you today so we can bring justice for Dylan.
Shane, Durango Herald. I'm curious if prosecutors, I'm not sure how this works, but are you able to seek an indictment before and maybe not have gotten one and then try again? Is this the first time you sought an indictment and were able to obtain one?
Question is whether this was the first attempt to seek an indictment from Mr. Redline. Mr. Champagne.
Thank you. The grand jury process is secret in nature, and the results and the details and the things that go on in the grand jury are not something that I can discuss in detail with you. What I can tell you is that we're very grateful and appreciative of the work of the grand jury on this case. They were dedicated and committed to this case, and they returned an indictment, which we think is appropriate, and we're moving forward from here.
Mr. Champagne, Sheriff Smith, one of the other thoughts, speculations that's coming out of the community since we've been here the past 48 hours, is credit to both of you. Several people have said to us, newly elected DA, newly elected sheriff, maybe a new focus on this case. And that's what they are speculating may have led to the arrest on Saturday, maybe a greater commitment. Is there any truth to that line of thinking?
whether Sheriff Smith's and the district attorney's relatively new election had any influence on the timing of this case.
A new and greater focus.
Sheriff Smith.
Politics or who's in office did not play a role in this case. From the very outset, this team of dedicated professionals has been working every day to bring this case to justice. It just happens to be happening on my watch. The fact is, we have been committed as a team all along. We finally got to the point where we needed to be to move forward.
As I stated earlier, I think the patience to wait for the case to be ready for prosecution is a challenge. From the beginning in 2012, my predecessor and myself have been working closely on this case with a team of investigators, with the family, and really the turning point, as I stated earlier, was finding Dylan's skull. That was a critical piece of evidence for us, but every part of that investigation, including the patience to wait until the case was ready, ended up being critical. As Sheriff Smith said earlier, we only get one chance at this, and we have to make the decision of when it's time to proceed with the prosecution, when we think our case is as good as it's ever going to get. And I think we've reached that point, which is why we presented the case now. But the patience that it took to get to this point was also an important piece of the puzzle and cannot be overlooked.
Shane Durango Herald. Have authorities recovered a tool or knife that was described in the affidavit that they believe may have been caused those injuries to the skull?
Question is whether investigators have found a tool or implement that may be used to cause damage to the skull. Sheriff Smith.
As I stated before, we're not going to be able to get in specifics about the evidence or try this case in this venue today. We are cognizant of the desire of the community to see this brought to resolution, and any specifics that would compromise the case are something that we can discuss. We will see this through to the end, and the evidence that collected, but we believe is strong enough to get the justice for Dylan that he deserves.
Additional questions?
Shane. I'm wondering if authorities ever worried about Mark Redwine for the last 4.5 years being a free person. Was he ever under surveillance? Was there ever a concern for other family members? How did you guys approach that?
Question is whether there was concern about Mr. Redwine's being free in the community over the last 4.5 years, and whether there was concern for safety of other family members.
This is really a matter of the internal investigation as it proceeded throughout the case. So it's not something that we can get into much detail about for you. In order to protect the integrity of the process, make sure that everybody in this case gets a fair trial, we're not going to want to delve into the details of the investigation outside what's already currently contained in the indictment.
Was Mr. Redwine under surveillance the entire 4.5 years or a portion of the 4.5 years, either through GPS or through monitoring? Can you share that? And then the second question is the role of a cadaver dog or dogs in the ultimate indictment. I realize there's probably parts you can't share, but what can you tell us about that part of this case?
Question regarding whether Mr. Redwine was under GPS or other types of surveillance, as well as the role of the cadaver dogs.
Maybe we can split this one and talk about it a little bit. So I'll take the first half of that question. The answer is no. He was not under GPS surveillance until such time as we received that search warrant after the indictment came back. However, I will tell you that my team was very much trying to keep aware of Mr. Redwine's whereabouts during the investigation.
As to the role of the cadaver dogs, we feel that was a critical part of the investigation as well. The cadaver dogs present strong evidence
placing a cadaver in Mr. Redwine's home, and cadaver scent on his clothing, as well as cadaver scent in his truck, the bed of his pickup truck. Obviously, that's important evidence that we'll be moving forward with and we'll be presenting in the trial when the time comes.
Explain how that process works, how those dogs are trained.
I don't have the expertise to explain the training of cadaver dogs. What I can tell you is that the dog that we're relying on, in part, is a highly trained and certified dog. It's participated in, I believe, in several hundred searches. And so this dog has proven to be very, from what we understand, very reliable in previous searches. And that it's going to be an important part of the case as we move forward.
Has the attention this case has from across not just Colorado or New Mexico, but the whole United States and been on national TV, how does that all play into the integrity of the case and moving forward as this process moves forward, tainting juries, those type of questions? How do we do a game plan right now moving forward?
Question is whether the national media attention that this case has gotten will have an effect on the judicial proceedings moving forward. Mr. Shankin.
I would love to be able to tell everybody in this community all the details of this case and be able to share it all with you right now. But in order to make sure that all the parties involved in the case get a fair trial, it's my ethical duty to be somewhat limited in what I can reveal. Part of that is the national media, the press coverage that's going on in this case, and that can have an impact on a jury pool. And again, my ethical duty is to try to protect the integrity of the case, make sure that we can try this case in La Plata County, and I'm going to do everything within my power to make sure that that happens.
Shane, Durango Herald. So can you confirm, Mr. Champagne, that you plan to file formal charges against Mark Redwine? And will they be second degree murder and child abuse causing death?
Question is confirmation of whether Mr. Champagne intends to file the charges articulated in the indictment. Mr. Champagne.
Thank you.
The short answer is yes. The next step in the process is that Mr. Redwine will be extradited back to Colorado. Upon his arrival here, he would be given an advisement by Judge Jeffrey Wilson, Chief Judge of our district, who will be handling the case. Part of that advisement will be the reading of the charges to Mr. Redwine, which will be murder in the second degree and child abuse resulting in death.
How does the governor's warrant expedite the extradition process? Is it a formal process? Does it ultimately help bring people back here quicker than otherwise?
The question is regarding the governor's warrant process and what the role is in bringing Mr. Redwine back to Colorado and whether it expedites that process. Mr. Champagne.
It's actually kind of the opposite. The governor's warrant is a somewhat cumbersome process. Our preference, of course, is that Mr. Redwine would be here as soon as possible. The quickest way for him to be extradited is for him to waive his right to challenge extradition, in which case he would simply agree to be extradited and would be returned quickly. The governor's warrant process is a lengthy process. It can take somewhere between 60 and 90 days. We're hopeful that we're going to be able to get it done more quickly than that in this case. I believe that the governor's office has been responsive already and is awaiting our governor's warrant application. We expect it to be delivered tomorrow morning to his office, and that he's going to act on it quickly, from what we understand. Then it's sort of beyond our control how the governor of Washington handles his extradition governor's warrant, but we're hopeful that he'll also treat it with the expediency it needs so that we can get Mr. Redwine back here and get justice done.
Whether there's still an active search planned for the case,
past 4.5 years, there have been numerous searches on Middle Mountain by hundreds of volunteers and professionals that came all across the state to help us do that. Our team does not believe that a search is necessary at this time. We were not coordinating that search to begin with. However, the investigative process doesn't end at the indictment. If there is a need to work with the folks that want to continue to search, we will, so that we can ensure if there is evidence of some kind found that is processed in a way that will not compromise it for the judicial process. We have began the process of reaching out to the folks that want to coordinate that search to find out what their goals are, and we will decide how we can plug in as needed. If other things arrive during the process, throughout the judicial process, we will determine if we have to do additional investigative follow-up on those as well.
Tony Kowalski again from Denver 7. Our team has obtained body camera video of the arrest, I'm sure you're aware. Can you tell us what your response is to what Mr. Redwine has said and is now in, out in public during that arrest on body camera video, and what, if anything, he said after he was off body camera video that you can share with us?
Question regarding what the response is to things that Mr. Redwine said during his arrest, captured on body camera, as well as anything he may have said afterwards. Sheriff Smith.
Kowalski, I'll say you're doing better than me. We have made a request for that information from the Bellingham Police Department, but we have not received that. We will be getting a packet from them, so I'm not in a position to comment as the statements that were made.
Anything made afterwards that you can share to your investigators?
As part of that request, we've requested the arresting officer's reports, so we haven't seen those as well. That will come as one packet to us. That will provide us with the statements.
Dovetailing off that a little bit, does that mean that investigators here have not met with Mr. Redwine or talked to him since his arrest?
Question is whether investigators from the sheriff's office have met with Mr. Redwine since his arrest. Sheriff Smith.
So as I said earlier, a team of three of our investigators went to Washington to work with authorities there on effectuating this arrest. Because of the turnaround of his truck being overweight, they were out of position by about 6 hours in order to assist directly in that. They did continue on to Whatcom County and worked with officials there. At that point, as it is his right to do, Mr. Redwine had invoked counsel, so that left us not in a position. Although they did have a brief meeting, there was not an opportunity for us to question him.
Many people that we've talked to have given credit to your detectives. You did that also, but can you share some specifics without causing problems with the integrity of your investigation about what they did or how they did it or how you got to that arrest on Saturday?
Question regarding some specifics that the investigative team may have experienced during their work on this case.
When I give them credit, it is because they are worthy of it. If you could see some of the video or photos that were taken of the process where they were on their hands and knees on a hillside like this looking for evidence, this is extremely rough terrain where we found the initial site for Dylan's remains. I've been there many times. Most people don't have an understanding until they're there. The efforts that they went through and some of the things that will come out about what we found and how we found it during the process of the case will shine a light on just what type of investigative efforts went into this. I can't share too much detail at this time, but trust me, it's not just giving credit. This was hard work to get to this point, and they deserve every bit of credit for that.
I'd just like to piggyback on that and say that the preparation, the knowledge of the case, the hours that these investigators have put in has been truly amazing. They have worked countless hours and tirelessly to get justice for Dylan. The entire Sheriff's Department deserves our great thanks and their work has been absolutely excellent in this case. There were some miracles that happened along the way in this case, and one of them is that we had such an amazing team participating and dedicated to this case.
Any further questions? Thank you all for coming. We appreciate your interest, and please see me if you'd like to arrange one-on-ones after this. Thank you.
So that's the conclusion of a news conference to discuss the arrest and indictment against Mark Redwine. Thanks for watching, and stay tuned with www.durangoherald.com, and we'll have more information out very soon. Thanks, guys.